Hello and welcome to Better Geology. I'm Andrew Dunning, and I'm at Palouse Falls in Washington, one of the most dramatic features of the Missoula Floods. The last major ice age blanketed North America starting about 2 million years ago, and it had its last major advance about 15,000 years ago, and we call this the last glacial maximum. The last glacial maximum did something very interesting here in the Northwest. Near the area of Ponderay in modern-day Idaho, this tongue of the Cordilleran Ice Sheet backed up the Clark Fork River to create an ice-dammed lake 320 kilometers long, 600 meters deep, and containing 2,100 cubic kilometers of water. That's half the volume of Lake Michigan. Periodically, this massive glacial lake would get too big, and the ice dam would burst, and the entire lake would drain out through the river canyons and wash out through the Columbia River, carving out the Columbia River Gorge and many, many other features across eastern Washington and Oregon. When this ice dam would burst and the water would rush out, it was moving as fast as 130 kilometers per hour, and in places as much as 200 meters deep. The force of this water rushing across the landscape excavated about 210 cubic kilometers of soil and rock from the landscape, and these carved, excavated areas are called the channeled scablands. Across these channeled scablands are deep channels carved by floodwaters, as well as rounded, streamlined features and huge bars of gravel and water-deposited sediment and rock. Glacial Lake Missoula is the largest ice-dammed lake known to have existed on Earth, and it may have formed and drained as many as 90 times, affecting what is now Spokane, but as many as 40 large floods reached the Columbia River. Right here at Palouse Falls, the effects of the Missoula floods are quite obvious. Many of the nearby hills are rounded off or carved away to expose the bedrock below. The bedrock here is all basalt, Columbia River flood basalt that actually erupted from dike swarms in this area. Right here at Palouse Falls, the Missoula floods are evidenced by this deep gouge in the bedrock. The original course of the Palouse River was to the north, and it flowed into the Columbia River. But when the floodwaters reached this area of the Columbia Plateau, they scoured out a large gouge along a fault zone, and that created a lower and shorter path for the Palouse River to dogleg to the south and reach the Snake River instead of the Columbia. The Palouse River can be considered by some geologists to be an unfit stream, meaning it is too small for it to have formed a canyon of this size in the amount of time that the river has existed. And that is an evidence of a large quantity of water rapidly scouring out this deep and dramatic canyon. As the huge amount of water from the Missoula floods washed down the Columbia River, it was occasionally impounded by narrow constrictions in its watercourse, namely the Wallula Gap at the head of the Columbia River Gorge and the Kalama Narrows, which are in Washington and Oregon, much farther south, closer to Portland. Now, these narrow constrictions backed up the floodwaters and allowed these temporary lakes to form for as many as weeks to months. And as the floodwaters ponded in these temporary lakes that dropped out a lot of the sediment and left these layers called varves and rhythmites, which are direct records of the number of floods which happened. Each flood is represented by a layer called a varve, which starts with coarser sediment and fines upward to the finest clays and silt on top. And each one of those ranges about centimeters to decimeters thick. And there are as many as 40 of these, and the entire sequence is called a rhythmite. Using carbon dating and some other methods, we can interpret that the floods occurred every 30 to 50 years over the course of about 2,000 years. The scale of a lot of these landforms in these floods is very difficult to comprehend, and it's difficult to see and understand from the ground, and it's really best viewed from satellite imagery and from an aircraft. And it's for this reason that the Missoula floods hypothesis was not widely accepted until the 1970s, and it was first proposed in the 1920s. And the geologist who first pitched them, Harlan Bretz, was ostracized from the community as a result until he was finally shown to be correct. One of the most interesting features of these floods are giant current ripples. Just as you get little ripples in streams and lakes and along the beach, you have giant current ripples that form along the bottom of the Missoula flood paths. From these giant current ripples, you can calculate the water depth and speed given the channel width, and it is from this that we are now able to understand and produce calculations for the flood volumes and sizes for the largest and the smallest floods. This has been Better Geology. I'm Andrew Dunning. Thank you for watching.